Hi, this is Brendan Kinney. I'm an engineer with the Google Maps Developer Relations team. Today I wanted to share with you a few simple tips on how the Chrome Developer Tools can make developing with the Google Maps APIs a whole lot easier. Now, if you've never opened up the DevTools before, you can do so by coming up here to the wrench menu, dropping down to Tools, and selecting Developer Tools. You can also use the really handy keyboard shortcuts Command-Option-I on the Mac and Control-Shift-I on Windows and Linux. Now, once they're opened up, you should see something familiar if you've ever used the developer tools on a lot of the major browsers. Over here on the left, we have an outline of all the DOM elements in the page. And if we select one, on the right, you'll see the matching CSS rules and the styles they apply to that element. But we're not that interested in that today. Instead, I like to stop by the network panel, where if we load a map, we can see all the files that had to be loaded in order to put this page and the map on the screen. What's great about this is we can look at any individual file and see if there's some kind of network problem, see if it's too large or bloated and we need to shrink that image. We can also see timing information to see, you know, how long it took for the server to respond, and then finally download that file. So that's pretty helpful. But what we're most interested in today is here in the developer console. Now, what the developer console gives us is actually an interactive JavaScript execution environment. What's more, it's the same execution environment that the page itself is running in. What this means is that the code that we write on our page and any code that we've loaded, like the Google Maps API, is actually code that we can interact with right now at runtime. Now, since maps are such a visual medium, this provides a great way to tweak our code and algorithms and see the results instantly, as opposed to going back to our source code, making an edit, saving, and then refreshing every time we want to make a small change. Now, in order to take advantage of this, we have to make a slight change to our source code so that everything that we need is in the global scope and we can find it right here in the console. So if we switch over, we can see that this map is a pretty typical Hello World example of the Maps API. We start off with an options object, which gives a default view and a map type. And we take that options object and a DOM element, and we can create our map itself. Now, the problem here is we're keeping a reference to the map, but we're declaring that reference inside this function. So as soon as this function is over, this reference is gone. Now, instead, we can take that reference and declare it outside in the global scope. And now, if we save and return to our page, now if we refresh and write map here, you can actually see that the console provides us with an interactive representation of the map object. You might even recognize some of the maps API here. So just as I said, we can now interact with this just as we would in the code on the page. So if I write map.getZoom, I can see the current zoom. But I can actually set things as well. So just as a really simple example, map.setZoom 5 gives us a nice zoomed out view of Sydney. Now, this actually brings up one of the things that is really handy just for setting up even a basic map. You want the perfect view to start off. So maybe we want to start off looking at Japan. So we find our nice view here. We come back down to the console, and you see that things have gotten kind of crowded with these network errors and warnings. So one really nice thing you can write is clear, and that'll actually clear the console. So I want to look at this view every time I want to open the map, so I can actually ask the map, what is the current view? So map.getZoom says that's level 10, and I can do map.getCenter to find out the center, but that'll return a lat-long object, and I'll have to kind of look at it and interrogate it. But what I can do to be extra sneaky, I know there's a toString method on here that will give me a string representation of the latitude and longitude of the center of the map. So now I can copy this, go back to the source code, paste it into the beginning, and I know I need to change my zoom to level 10. Now when I save this and then refresh the page, you can see that I'm now starting exactly where I want it to. Let's look at a slightly more advanced example. Now here we have the amazing wireframe that my designer gave me for our new site. So I've taken that wireframe and dropped it into the background of this page, and he's told me that a map needs to go here in the center area. So I've restructured the page a bit, put a div there, and dropped a map in it. But as you can clearly see, nothing is there. So let's open up the DevTools and try and figure out what's going on. The first thing we notice is this JavaScript error, cannot set property position of undefined. Now, the problem is I never set a property name position at any point in my code, so that seems a little bit odd. If I drop down this arrow here, I can actually see a stack trace of all the functions that were called that led to this error. But once again, I see a bunch of function names that I don't recognize. Knee and to and j.o aren't functions that I ever wrote in my own code. And the explanation for this can be found here on the right, where you can see that all these errors took place in main.js. But that's a JavaScript file that was loaded by the Maps API, not by me. Now my first instinct might be to go file a bug on the Maps API. After all, the error is happening in their code. But I have a sneaking suspicion that the problem actually lies in my own. I started with known good working code, the earlier example, and added to it and changed it until I could get it to work in this design. So it's possible I introduced a bug somewhere in the steps in between. There are a few ways we can track down this problem. One is the old-fashioned brute force method of starting with the known good code and then adding the new code line by line, saving and refreshing every time until we finally encounter the bug. A somewhat better approach would be to use the console object. Console is an object that lives on window in the global scope and it provides an API so that your JavaScript code can utilize the developer console here just as if you were sitting here typing on it. Now, one of the most helpful methods that it provides is the log method, which basically just logs statements to the developer console. So it's just console.log and some value, so here's a string, and there you go. So let's switch over to the source for this page. And you can see things are mostly the same here, and so I'm going to guess that maybe I changed something in my options that caused a problem. So I'm just going to add a console.log statement here, my options, and we save it and come back here and refresh. Now we can see before this error statement, I do indeed have an object here, and I can look, and as we did before, we can see that, well, okay, the center looks right, the map ID looks right, and zoom looks right, so maybe that's not the issue. So let's switch back over to our source code. Here we have the log statement. Now we can add one after map div and make sure that's okay, and one after map and make sure that's okay. But you can tell as this scales to hundreds and thousands of lines of code, it's not really feasible anymore to use console.log. Log is great for actual logging, but if you have hundreds and thousands of lines to go through to find out where the problem occurred, you really haven't made your problem any easier. So let's get rid of this console log statement. Go back to our page. So the last approach I want to take to solving this problem lies in the scripts panel. Now the scripts panel has kind of an intimidating UI, and I think a common first reaction to seeing it is, you know, the JavaScript problem you're facing today isn't tough enough to justify the time it'll take to learn how to use the scripts panel. But it turns out the tools available here are enough to solve basically any JavaScript problem, so it's really worth at least trying out. Here on the left, you can see all the JavaScript files that were loaded to create this page. This can be a little confusing at first until you notice that the top of each tree has the domain listed. So here, localhost is where I'm hosting most of my files, and mapgrid.html is my main page. So when I open it up, you can see the full source of the page, and then down here the actual JavaScript that's executing. Now, like the debuggers in many languages, the scripts panel provides a way to set breakpoints. So if I click here on a line of code, the JavaScript engine will actually pause execution when it reaches this line and allow me to kind of inspect state interactively. Now the problem here is, of course, that the breakpoint is in the initialize function, which is executed when the page is first loaded. But as long as we have the developer tools open, we can actually refresh the page, and Chrome will remember our breakpoint and pause there. So now we've paused before things have even started and in our initialize function, and so now we can take a look at what's going on. Up here in the top right, we have the buttons that kind of control our experience during this debugging session. First, we have a resume button that just resumes execution as if there never was a breakpoint. We have a step over button, and this will let us move from line to line and actually see how each line develops within this function. And then we actually have a step into button that will go and dig down into any functions that we encounter so we can see what's going on in those functions as well. Now in this case, we don't really have any function calls that we're interested in. We have a lat long and map constructors, but that's just obfuscated code. And then we have actually the selector for the map canvas div, but that just digs into jQuery code. So in this case, we're only going to be using the step over button. So below here, you can see all the variables we're going to be using within this function. The map div objects we're going to be initializing down here, and the my options object we're about to initialize. And if you're really brave, you can see all the global variables that are available at this point. The problem is there's a whole lot of them. Everything that's declared in Windows is listed here. But if we scroll down to M, you can see our lonely little map that we're going to be constructing soon, and we put in the global scope here.
but we're not that interested in the global variable, so let's collapse that. And we can start looking through this code step by step. So if we hit step over, we execute this statement, and the myOptions object is now initialized. And you can see, just as when we logged it to the console.log, everything looks okay. We have a center, and we have the correct type, map type ID and the correct zoom. So let's keep going. In this next line, we use jQuery to select the correct map canvas div that we're going to use to create the map. So if we execute that statement, we can now see something kind of strange. Map div is set to e.fn.e.init1, which is definitely not what we'd expect. We'd expect some kind of representation of a DOM element. Once again, our secret weapon for figuring out what's going on is the developer console. Now I could go over to the developer console panel, or I could hit escape and get a mini one right here. So I want to figure out what's going on with map div, so I'll just log that and see what's going on. And it looks like I do have the correct DOM element, but it's inside an array for some reason. So at this point, I would know that this came back from the jQuery function, so I'd go and check the jQuery docs. And I'd remember that the jQuery function doesn't return the selected objects directly. It actually creates a new jQuery object with those objects associated with it. Now this is great for jQuery because it allows all the really fun jQuery function chaining that you can do with jQuery. The problem is the maps API expects a DOM element directly and not something wrapped up in another object. To fix the issue, I want to come back to my source code. And there's a couple of ways you can do this, but the easiest one I find is just .get0. And since I know this is an ID and there's only one of them, 0 is the appropriate index to use. I save it, come back here, and I can exit from DevTools. And when I refresh the page, there's my map. And there's the basic introduction to using the Chrome developer tools with the Google Maps APIs. If you don't use any developer tools today, you should really try them out. And I think you'll find your life as a developer will become considerably easier, and you'll be able to concentrate on problems that actually matter. If you'd like to know more, you can visit this link, and you can find a list of all the commands and APIs available, as well as further screencasts that gives more information into using the developer tools.